رب زدني علما.
The issue of insurance is one of the conventional insurance that is done, is one of the issues that our ulama, our contemporary ulama, have seriously dealt with. They first started talking about this in 1975. After the first Islamic bank has already been established, which was the Dubai Islamic Bank. In the same year, in 1975, also the Islamic Development Bank was established. In that year, some of our contemporary ulama, they started making observations over the conventional insurance. Because the conventional insurance, it consists of elements that are unacceptable in Islam. The first element that is there is the element of what is called gharar, the uncertainty. Now, the Prophet, in a hadith of Abu Huraira, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam naha an bay'il gharar. The Prophet prohibited the sale of uncertainty. Now the uncertainty can be in the price, can be in the commodity, can be in the term of the transaction, and it can be in any conditionality which is placed in the transaction. Now in conventional insurance, there is uncertainty in the price, there is uncertainty in the commodity. Because in a case where you are buying protection, you don't know whether you are going to have a mishap, an accident is going to occur or it's not going to occur. And you don't know what you are paying for. If, for instance, you insure your house and then there is no fire, and all along you've been paying for several years. So all that money that you paid, it has gone for nothing because there was no fire. So you didn't get any recompense. So you paid for something which you did not get. So that is a gharar. It's just like you pay, you go to somebody who is catching fish, and you say, I will buy the fish that you are going to catch today. You give him your money, and he tries and tries and tries again, no fish. So you paid, and at the end of the day, he said, no fish, give me my money. He said, I already paid. Then I'm going to argue. I said, no, I paid for a fish, but I didn't get a fish. So what do you want? I've already collected your money. It was a sale contract with you. So there is going to be a dispute. And in the Sharia, anything that will lead to dispute and argumentation, the Sharia prevents it. So this is, there is gharar in that. There is also gharar in what you get. If, for instance, you only pay the first installment of the insurance, then you have a fire and they have to pay you. They pay you. They have to pay you. They don't know how much they are going to. They don't know how much you are going to pay for them, and they are ready to pay you for the fire, which they don't know how much damage it is going to do. So they are not certain over what they are going to give, which is the commodity, and they are not certain over what they are going to get. This is a contract that has no basis in Islam. Also, in insurance, there is devouring people's wealth without due cause. أكل المال بالباطل. And Allah has said in the Quran, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل إلا أن تكون تجارة عن تراض منكم. O you who believe, do not squander the wealth of one another without due cause, except if it is based on a sale transaction that is based on agreement between you. How does it happen in insurance? In insurance, when you pay little and you get much, that much that you are getting, on what account did you get it? On no account. So it is aklul mali bil batil. You are devouring people's wealth without due cause, because it is the what others have contributed and they were saved from the mishap, you take their money. If on the other hand, you give and give and give and nothing happened and the insurance company is taking that money, on what account is it taking that your money without having to pay for it? That they are, so they are also doing akl al-mali bil batil. And also the insurance, when they gather the pool of the insurers' fund, the people who are given the funds, usually they invest them in what they call long-term securities. These long-term securities, they are mostly government borrowings. When the government borrows from people, they give interest, the so-called treasury bills. So the insurance company, if it gathers your money, it is going to buy those treasury bills, and the government pays interest over that. So you are actually pulling all your wealth so as to go and give it to an interest transaction. So based on this, the ulama, they said that the element of ghara, akl al-mali bil-batil, and riba make conventional insurance haram and not permissible in Islam. So they started, they said, then what is the alternative? What is the alternative? Because what the insurance is doing is something that as a principle, Islam accepts it, that is to ward off loss upon yourself. Anything that will protect your wealth is welcome in the Sharia, because Allah has given us this wealth and He said we should not squander it. So anything that will protect the wealth is welcome in Islam. So there has to be an alternative. So they started, the ulama, they started coming up with alternatives, and they came up with the concept of cooperative insurance, or what they call at-takafu, which is taking, making the contributions, making the insurance premiums as contributions, not as a sale contract, but as a contribution. Just like what happened in Medina during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was a practice of one of the clans, a Yemeni clan, the Ash'ariyun. They were from Yemen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he praised them. What was the thing they were doing? When they are on a journey, or when they are inside Medina and they realize that their provision is about to finish, then they will say everybody should bring his own contribution. The food that he has in his store, he should bring it. When they bring it together, then they will share it among themselves equally. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ana minhum wa hum minni." They are of me and I am of them. What does this mean? He is praising what they are doing. So what they are doing is like, is the basis of cooperative insurance. People will pool their resources together. But in terms of distribution, you will get not on the basis of what you contributed, but on the basis of your need. So if you are in a need, like a mishap happens to you, you will be paid from the pool. But when you give, you are giving it as a donation, not as a sale contract. And in Sharia, if a contract is a contract of contribution, of donation, then the terms that are stipulated for a sale contract, they are made lighter in terms of a donation contract. For a donation contract, you can do a contract of gharar. You can donate, you can say, Malam Zahraddin, you know that my car that was stolen 2 years ago, I've given it to you as a gift. That is permissible. And then it is his business to go and see. If he gets it, if he finds it, he takes it. If he doesn't find it, I have no, it was a donation. But I did not collect anything from him. You understand? If I collected something from him and I sold to him my stolen car, then I benefited, but he does not, he may benefit, he may not benefit. But in a donation, in a contract of contribution, in a contract of donation or benevolence, that is acceptable. So based on this, the alternative was brought, which is the takaful. There are still some Sharia issues in the takaful. Still is not that perfect, but at least it is going towards taking people away from haram to what is halal. Because no matter the situation in the world, Allah will put an opening for the believers. As Izzuddin bin Abdul Salam has said, if the whole world is full of riba, Allah will put an opening for the believers. So it's not perfect, the alternative to conventional insurance that we have, which is Takafu, is not perfect, but it is gradually developing towards making it as near to the Sharia as possible, inshallah. You know, it's the question is what advice can be given to students of knowledge, especially the ones who are studying hadith. This itself definitely is a lecture in itself, but the most important thing for any student of knowledge, after purifying his intention, which is the most fundamental thing, to have a good intention, then is to pursue the means to acquire that knowledge, because everything has a means. There is asbab for everything, to pursue the means. The issue of intention is very important, because as the ulama ul hadith themselves have said, when we started we pursued this knowledge with an intention, that is, with a sound intention, make it just for the sake of Allah and Allah alone. Knowledge of hadith is certainly a very lofty knowledge, because knowledge of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the people of this knowledge, they are the ones that Allah tabaraka that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has referred to when he said, there shall not cease to be a party, a group from among my community, upright on the way of truth. Those who oppose them, or those who do not help them, will not harm them in the least till the affair of Allah comes to pass. لا تزال طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله. And Imam Ahmad says, these are the people of hadith. So indeed, it's a very great thing, because for you to be a custodian of the sayings and the practices of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is indeed tremendous, because you have what the fuqaha need in order to arrive at a judgment. The fuqaha, when they don't know hadith, they will go to qiyas. But when you know hadith, you will just say, this is the judgment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what you say will be final. The ulama, they will leave their qiyas, they will leave their qawaid, they will leave their usul and come back to you. So indeed, hadith is tremendous. And for you to pursue the knowledge of hadith, you have to seek the means of the knowledge, which is to have a very good knowledge of Arabic language. As Ibn Abdul Barr has said, that you have to have a very good knowledge of Arabic language first and foremost, because the hadith, a deep understanding of the hadith, will only be done in the Arabic language. You can't understand hadith from translation, because translation, no matter how accurate it is, it cannot convey the true import of the Arabic language. So you have to have a very good knowledge, a working knowledge of the Arabic language. What it means, a working knowledge of the Arabic language, is that even if you are an Arab, you need it. Because even if you are an Arab, you need to have a working knowledge of the Arabic language, you need to learn Arabic. So this is very important. And then you start by, you also need to be ready for memorization, because you should always relate the hadith with the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can relate the meaning, but if you don't memorize it, you won't know the meaning, because you may end up bringing a muggle, saying what he did not say, or bringing one hadith into another. So you have to be ready to memorize. And usually they say you start gradually. You start by memorizing the 40 hadiths of An-Nawawi, then gradually you go to the other collections, small collections of hadith, like the Umdat al-Ahkam, and then some after Umdat al-Ahkam, they go to Al-Muntaqa of Ibn al-Jarud, before they used to, after they used to start by memorizing the Muwatta, as Ibn Abdul Barr said, but now who will memorize the Muwatta? I mean, if you can't memorize, then you have to, what one of the scholars of hadith has said, idmanu nadhar fi sahihain. That is, always immerse yourself in always reading and reading the sahihain, Bukhari and Muslim, reading it over and over again. Because when you read it a lot, even if you don't memorize it exactly as it is, you can't recite it, but at least you will imbibe what it has been saying. This is very important, because now, how many of us have read Bukhari from beginning to end? But here they are saying, idmanun nadhar, that is, read it over and over and over again. So you need to do that, and then you need to understand the terminal, the way the ulama ul hadith, they structured their field of knowledge. They have their own terminologies, which is the ilm al mustala. You need to know it. You need to know what they mean when they mention the terminology they use in the isnad or in the matn. You also need to know how they arrive at their judgment. Because arriving at the judgment on hadith, whether it is acceptable or not acceptable, is based on certain principles. You need to know those principles. It's a long process, but it is always easy if you are perseverant. But you have to follow a structured pattern. You can't, and the best way to do that is to enter into a structured program for that. A structured program under a school or a college or an institute, or under a teacher who has a structured program that will he will take you through to the level when you become proficient in it, inshallah. Why Umar is called Abu Hafs? Hafs is one of the names of lion, a lion in the Arabic language. Is one of the names of a lion in the Arabic language is Hafs. So he's called that to show his valor and his strength. Usually the Arabs, they used to say, نسمي أبناءنا لأعدائنا ونسمي فتياننا لأنفسنا. When we give a name to our sons, we give them a name because of our enemies, so as to strike fear into the hearts of our enemies. But when we give a name to our servants, we give them a name for ourselves, so that we can call them with very soft names. So they call them like Maysara, ease. They call them Sahal, ease. But when they want to their own sons, because they are the ones who are going to fight, when they go into the battle, then they, when the enemies, they ask who is holding the flag, they will say, is someone called Hanzala? Hanzala, bitter. Hanzala is a very bitter fruit. That is, whoever meets him, he will have nothing but bitterness. So it will strike fear into the hearts of the enemies. So this is the custom of the enemies. So like, when they hear that the one who is holding the, who is at the front is Abu Hafs, and the father of the lion, so it will strike fear into the hearts of the people. So that is the why Umar is called that. Is among the custom of the, is a custom that was done by the Arabs, and it was permitted in Islam, even though some very bad names, they were changed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like Huzn, you know, Huzn, grief. Somebody was called grief, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam changed his name, but he didn't want the name to be changed. And his grandson, who was one of the notable scholars, Sayyid Ibn al-Musayyib, he said, that quality of grief, it did not stop being in us since my grandfather refused to change his name. Because he's Sayyid Ibn al-Musayyib Ibn Huzn. He did not change his name because it was not like a command that he has to change. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he recommended for him to change the name. And he said, no, I don't want to change a name that was given to me by my father. So because of that, the influence of the name, it continued in their family. And Sayyid Ibn al-Musayyib said, it is still with us, grief. We feel aggrieved. You know, there are people who are like that, who just feel as though nothing is going on well with them. They just feel aggrieved and they are in agony and worry and anxiety. Part of the thing that brings that is when you have a name that has got that meaning in it. Because names have got secrets. This is what we learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, but Islam accepted that custom of the Arabs, but it changed where the custom was taken to a reasonable limit. Now regarding the second question, which is the meaning of the hadith, مَنْ قَالَ لِأَخِيهِ يَا كَافِرْ فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِهِ فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِهَا أَحَدُهُمَا. Whoever calls his brother Muslim, or you kafir, then one of them has taken it upon himself. Now this hadith is one of the hadith that the ulama have spoken extensively about, because the outward meaning is not what is intended. By simply calling your brother a kafir, if you call him a kafir, then if he is not a kafir, then you become a kafir. Yeah, it will only be so if by calling him a kafir, you mean that he is, despite his belief, his belief is still not acceptable in the sight of Allah. That is, his belief in Allah and his belief in the Messenger does not make him a believer. Now, if you do that, it's as though you are rejecting Iman yourself. That is, if you believe in that. So if he is not like that, and you are declaring him that his belief is not belief, then it's as though you are rejecting Al-Iman. So it's not by just calling him Ya Kafir that you become a Kafir, but definitely by calling a Muslim who is not, this hadith shows that it is one of the gravest sins to call a Muslim a kafir, because it is the thing that a Muslim holds dearest is his iman. And now to declare him that he doesn't have that iman is the greatest insult that you can give to him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, "Sibabul Muslimi fusuq." Insulting a Muslim is transgression. So it is an insult, and what insult will be more than to negate somebody's iman? And usually, people who declare, you can't declare somebody a kafir because there are a lot of things that come along with it. It's a judgment. It's a judgment which only a judge can make. Because when somebody becomes a kafir, his marriage is severed. There is no inheritance between himself and his children. So many judgments follow. That is why it is not done except in a court. A judge will make that declaration. It's not somebody who is making da'wah to say, those such and such people, they are kuffar. No, you don't do takfirul mu'ayyan. You can say that this and such an act is kufr. But to imply that the person, even if somebody committed that act, to declare him a kafir, you don't do that. Because it could be he didn't know. And if he didn't know, the judgment will not be on him. or there is something to prevent the judgment being leveled upon him. So that is why it can only be done by a judge, because there are repercussions, there are things that follow the judgment. This hadith is a hadith that is sahih, and it is also accepted by the fuqaha. That is, anything which a large quantity causes intoxication, then taking a small quantity is also haram. Because what this means is that any drink that has an intoxicant in it, then it is haram to take even a small part of it. Even the measure that does not intoxicate is haram to take it. Now, this is the position of the majority of the fuqaha. The fuqaha of Hijaz, Makkah, Medina, Sham, except some fuqaha in Iraq, who see that only the intoxicating amount is not permissible. But this is not correct. Because of this hadith, their position is weak. So anything that causes intoxication, when you take a large amount, then even taking a sip of it is haram, because it shows that it has got an intoxicant. Now, to apply this hadith on shisha and cigarette, that is something else. Shisha and cigarette, do they have intoxicants in it? If they have intoxicants, that is, and how do you know they have intoxicants? Either from the chemical composition or from the practice of taking it. The people who smoke, if they smoke for a long time, if it causes intoxication, then that smoking is haram. The people who smoke shisha, if it is known that if they take shisha, a big quantity of shisha, it will cause intoxication, then taking even a puff of shisha is haram. But then, if they are not like that, then their judgment will be based on other considerations. Because a thing, the thing that will cause, that will give a drink or a smoke or a food that you are taking to give it the judgment of being haram is not just because of intoxication. It may not be an intoxicant. It may not cause intoxication, but it could have, there could be another basis for making it haram. And as far as I know, the fatwa of our ulama regarding cigarette and regarding shisha is that it is haram, based on two things. The first one is, it is squandering wealth. It is israf. Because you are just, it's as though you are just burning your money. Because there is no benefit behind it. There is no benefit at all. So it is just like you are squandering your money. And the second reason why they say it is haram is because it is established that it is harmful to your health. It is established. And that is why in certain countries they make it a condition, like in the US, that the Surgeon General, who is the chief medical officer of the US government, the Surgeon General has said that cigarette is harmful to your health and it can cause early death. And among the established harmful effects of cigarette is that prolonged use will lead to lung cancer, would lead to liver failure, so many diseases which they mentioned, so many of them. And the judgment of the Sharia is that anything that is harmful to your health is haram. In usul, one of the fundamental rules of the Sharia in usul al-fiqh, as in one of the texts of usul al-fiqh, which they said, wa aslu kulli ma yadhurru al-man'u. The fundamental rule regarding anything that causes harm is that it is prohibited. So since it is established that it causes harm, and there is, this is something which is universally accepted. It's not the opinion of one or two medical doctors, or the opinion of one or two countries, but it is universal. So based on that, the ulama, this is the fatwa that we had from our own ulama, from our own scholars, that it is prohibited. But I never had any one of them saying that shisha or cigarette is prohibited because it is an intoxicant. If it intoxicates, then definitely that is another reason for its being haram. But even if it doesn't intoxicate, the fatwa of the ulama, from the reasons that I gave, they are enough to make it haram. Now, the first question is, what is the judgment regarding a Muslim marrying a woman that is Christian or Jew? Or a Muslim woman marrying a non-Muslim? So there are two aspects of the question. A Muslim man marrying a Christian or Jew? Or Jewess, a Christian woman or Jewish woman. This one is permissible because it says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, "Al-yawma uhilla lakum at-tayyibat." On this day, good things are made permissible to you. Wa ta'amul ladhina utul kitaba hillun lakum wa ta'amukum hillun lakum. And the food slaughtered by those who are given books before you is permissible to you. And the food, your own food, is permissible to them. وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. And the chaste women from among the believers, and the chaste women from among those who are given a book before you. And the ones who are given books before us are the Jews and the Christians. There is difference of opinion regarding the Magians, the Majus, because they don't have a book. But some ulama, they said, we give them their judgment because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, sunnu bihim sunnat ahl al-kitab. Treat them with the practice of the ahl al-kitab. So does that include even marriage? So those, some ulama are saying that yes, some ulama are saying no. And the best is, because al-aslu fil furuj, the issue of marriage is very delicate. You don't engage into it except with certainty. You are certain, we are certain about Jews and Christians. We are not certain about other than them. So a Muslim does not get married to them. And it was the practice, the Sahaba, they undertook this practice. Abdullah ibn Umar, he married a Christian woman. Hudhaifa, he married a Jewish woman. And Sayyidina Umar, he objected. He said, if you say it is haram, I will divorce her. He said, I don't say it is haram, but I don't want people to be saying that a companion of the Prophet is marrying a Jewish woman. Say, so if you say it is haram, I will divorce her. So he didn't like it. Umar didn't like the idea because he didn't like the influence. It could send a wrong signal. There are people who could be weak in their faith, and they will go and marry a Jewish woman or a Christian, and then he will lose his sons to her if she is strong, and it happens. So he didn't want that thing to happen because he was thinking at the influence that will have. Hudhaifa, he is strong in faith, but others may not be that strong. So somebody may marry a woman who is stronger than him, and he will end up if she doesn't influence him to leave his religion, she may influence his children. And this has happened a lot. So it is permissible, but somebody should always, if Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has said, if Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has prohibited us from marrying a slave girl, except in certain strict conditions, for fear of what will happen to our children, we should think of that. For fear of what will happen to your children, think before marrying a woman who is a Jewish, who is Jewish or Christian. But the other aspect of the question, a Muslim woman marrying a non-Muslim, that one is not permissible by the ijma of the fuqaha. By the ijma of the fuqaha, they say it's not permissible. Why? Because Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has said, لَا هُنَّ حِلٌّ لَهُمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحِلُّونَ لَهُمْ. The believing women, they are not permissible to the unbelievers, nor are the unbelievers permissible to the believing women. And also in the Quran it said, وَلَنْ يَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ لِلْكَافِرِينَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ سَبِيلًا. Allah will not put for the unbelievers a way of control over the believers. Now if you put a Muslim woman under a non-Muslim man, then you are giving a non-Muslim control over a Muslim. And Allah said will not do that. So, I mean, the Sharia will not condone that. So this is also one of the reasons that the fuqaha base their judgment that it's not permissible for a Muslim woman to be married to a non-Muslim man. And the second question is, ما هو الحديث الذي يوضح صفات إمام المسجد أو من أحق الناس بالإمامة في الصلاة؟ The hadith that explains the qualities of the one who is supposed to be an imam. Yeah, the hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, which says that the person who is supposed to lead, he will be the one who is the best of the congregation in Quran. Ya ummul qawm aqra'uhum li kitabillah. The one who has who is most knowledgeable of the book of Allah, he will be the imam of a people. Then if they are all the same in recitation, fa'alamuhum bis sunnah, then the one who is most knowledgeable in the sunnah. If they are all knowledgeable in the sunnah, fa'aqdamuhum hijra, then the one who did the hijra first. And if they are all the same in terms of hijrah, because the people who do hijrah, they are more knowledgeable of the religion than the ones who come after. Then if they are all the same in the hijrah, فَأَقْدَمُهُمْ سِنَّنْ أَوْ سِلْمَنْ. Is it سِنَّنْ أَوْ سِلْمَنْ? So it's a riwayatain. Then if they are the same in hijrah, then the one who is older in terms of fear. In another narration it tells, the one who accepted Islam earliest. So there, because you know, silman and sinnan, they will be written almost the same. So the muhaddithun, they recite it in two ways. So based on this, the fuqaha, they differ among themselves, because they see that this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, but then during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said Abu Bakr should lead the people in prayer. And Abu Bakr was not the most knowledgeable of the Quran among the Sahaba, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself said Aqra'ukum Ubay. The one who is the most knowledgeable of Quran among you is Ubay ibn Ka'ab, including Abu Bakr. So Ubay, he knew the Quran more than everybody among the Sahaba, including Abu Bakr. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Abu Bakr should lead the people. Muru Abu Bakr falyusalli bin nas. Tell Abu Bakr, or command Abu Bakr to pray for the people. Now based on this, the fuqaha, they became different. Malik and Shafi'i, they said that the one who is most knowledgeable of the judgment of what is contained in the Quran, even if he has not memorized most of the Quran, should be the one who should be in prayer. Just like what he said regarding Abu Bakr. But Imam Ahmad, he said, no, we go by the clear hadith, the one who knows the Quran most should be the one leading in prayer. Then when he is asked, what about what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? He did not, he knew the hadith, but he said, Muru Aba Bakr falyusalli binnas. He said he did that for another thing. He asked them to put Abu Bakr in prayer because he was indicating that Abu Bakr is going to be the Khalifa after him. So that was why he did not walk with the hadith, but the hadith is still there. But always you take the greatest maslaha, because there was another maslaha that was behind it, which is the fact that he wanted to indicate that the one who will take his position after him is Abu Bakr. He did not ask them to bring Ubay to lead in prayer. He asked them to bring Abu Bakr to lead in prayer. So based on this, it is the position of Imam Ahmad is the strongest in that. So it is always when you have someone who has memorized more than the others, he should be the one to pray. When we are in Medina, in the Islamic University, always in the university mosque, the people who will be the imams were always from Kulliyatul Quran, the Quran faculty, because in the Quran faculty you are not admitted till you have memorized the Quran. So anyone who is from the faculty of Quran, he has memorized the, and what is meant by the one who has more knowledge of the Quran is more memorization. The one who has